I wanted to share with you some technical aspects. It's a focus on a very technical part inside the code, on a very localized part. But I wanted to share this with you because we are a developer. We are supposed to be a developer meeting. And I wanted to show you how a choice of design of data structure at the beginning of the implementation 10 years ago was difficult to handle today, adding more and more and more physics into the computation. So it's about PAW again. I know that after my talk, people will ask the question, it is worth doing all of this in PAW? Yes, it is. I'm convinced of that. And it's okay. I wanted to share you the technical aspect. I have two topics in my talk. I think I will not have the time to go into the DGA part, but it's on the slide. So at start, Nathalie, when was it? 12, 15 years ago, 12 years ago, we decided to implement PAW in Abinit, and we made choices for the data structures. It was the beginning of the structured data type in Abinit, and it was only for non-polarized ground state systems, and now we are in the way or having non-collinear spin orbit, GGA, DFPT, order 1, 2, 3, and so on. I had some work in last November to adapt everything to that because I was not able to mix all this formalism. So, PAW, as Joe said, I don't have time to go into details, but most of you know now what is PAW. You add this additional localized basis to the plane waves, and you have this PAW on-site contributions to compute. And when you want to go from a non-conserving pseudo-potential code to a PAW one, you have four kind of additional lines in your code. The three first ones are already in the US ultrasub pseudo-potential formalism. The only addition of PAW are these on-site terms. So you have to take into account the non-orthogonality of pseudo function. You have to use a compensation charge density. Your non-local operator is self-consistent, and you have these additional on-site contributions. And the Hamiltonian look like this. This non-local operator is now self-consistent, and it is not an equality. These terms is in some way to view that it's an expression of the Hamiltonian in the localized basis, in the PAW basis. So you have your Hamiltonian into partial waves of the PAW basis, and in this Hamiltonian, you have the usual density, and you have extra densities. And these are on-site densities expressed only with the partial waves, PAW partial waves basis element. And these densities depend on the PAW occupancy matrix, which is expressed there, which is a sum over wave functions. And this was the term that Theo this morning referred to. This term that he has parallelized over TGB for DMFT. So you have these two quantities, rho ij and dij. These quantities, I call them on-site quantities, PAW on quantities. And of course, as this is the connection with my talk of yesterday, this is the time-consuming part, the projection. So you have this Hamiltonian in between two partial wave bases, and just a focus on exchange correlation. It is located there, and it can be expressed in terms of the localized basis and the rho ij matrix, and it can also be expanded in spherical harmonics. And this could be the topics of the second part of my talk, but this probably will not be. So these two quantities have symmetries. Rho ij is emission, but in the ground state, non-polarized, simple case, you don't use the imaginary part of Rij, and Dij is symmetric, and of course the contribution to the total energy make is a real term. So at start we decided to store these quantities like this. We have two data structures, one per atom, and inside this data structure we have the values, one per spin and one per Ij couple, and this term is packed, but it's only a detail because there are several due to symmetries you can have several zeros inside. So okay, this was the initial choice, and it was simple implementing. This is in the LiPo library and so on. So now we go to non-collinear magnetism. So it has been shown by Eric, so I can go directly to the end of the slide. You have a 2x2 matrix for the density and so on. And Eric didn't show that. You can go from the 2x2 matrix formalism to the density magnetization formalism via the Pauli matrices. But okay, it's non-collinear magnetism. It's not complicated. Just to mention that in Abinit, the potential, the Hamiltonian and so on are use this formalism, and the density is handled with this formalism, N and M. And when you go to PAW, you have the same. All the on-site densities can be expressed as 2x2 matrices, and you can use the Pauli matrices to go from one representation to the other. And the occupancy matrix is the same. You have a contribution for each spinor, alpha and beta, and you can have several 2x2 matrices or a couple of an occupancy matrix and what we could name an occupancy magnetization. And at the end, the Hamiltonian is the same. The contribution to the Hamiltonian has two spinor components. And as you see, as Eric said, the real coupling of the spinors is in the exchange correlation term because all the other terms are spin diagonal. Okay, so spin orbit coupling and PAW. And it's strange because I put, the reference is there. It's a pretty old paper of the VASP team, Ops, Christian, after in 2000. And spin orbit coupling, I don't want to go into details, but spin orbit coupling, to obtain that, you have to add the spin orbit Hamiltonian in the Hamiltonian. So in PAW, you take the spin orbit Hamiltonian between two basis elements, and this can be expressed like this. You have to handle the spinors and the partial wave basis. This is done in Abinit. And in this Hamiltonian has been shown by Niels this morning. This is the spin orbit Hamiltonian. You can make some assumptions to reduce the complexity of the calculation. You make the assumption that the potential is quasi-spherical and that the density is mainly in the PAW region. And if you do this assumption, you obtain an angular part and a radial part that you can compute not so complicated way. Not, and this is the important point, that this quantity is complex and no more real. Okay, this quantity in the standard constant Hamiltonian was real. Okay, so what is the consequence on the PAW quake quantities? The consequence is, okay, the total on-site energy is still real, but the symmetry relation change. You have you have this symmetry relation. You have this matrix is no more only Hermitian with respect to the partial waves, but also with respect to the spinor component, and you have but if you use the other formalism, it is still Hermitian, and the same for the Hamiltonian, for the non-local operator. And we decided to store this. It was not so complicated. We had the fact that we have four spinors coupled, and that the fact that it is complex. So we had okay at that time. It was not so complicated. Okay, then density functional perturbation theory. So it has been presented yesterday, you know that. So expansions, in perturbation to n plus 1 theorem, Sternheimer equation. This is a PAW version of the Sternheimer equation. And we use parallel transport gauge. And if you do that, you can exploit. And OK, this is for general, the general formalism, but we want to obtain phonon spectra, so we want incommensurate perturbations. If you do that, you can exploit the periodicity of the potential. And you have a periodicity of the first-order potential of the first-order wave function, including the perturbation. And this is explained in the famous 97 paper of Xavier. And you have this expansion with respect to the perturbation, including the Q vector, and this famous trick of the phase factorization. You can handle some phase. You can handle quantities once you have factorized the phase, and they have a Q index, and they have a phase, so they become complex. And this is not the same complex as for the spin orbit. So PAW, you take your expression of the rho ij, you derivate on the left, on the right, in the middle. So it's not, it's long, but it's not complicated. And you obtain this expression for the rho ij, sorry. And applying the periodicity of Q of psi, sorry, of psi, this formula, and it's not the same factorization, but factor, and you can factorize a phase, and you can obtain some quantities for the PAW on-site scalars, and you see they have a phase, they contain a phase with the position of the atom, and so they are complex they are complex and they have another symmetry. The second order on-site the contribution of the outside terms to the second order energy is not so complicating to obtain. You have to derivate rho ij, dij, or one of the one of these two, but only at constant wave functions. This is for experts. But okay, so these two terms are not complicated to obtain. This one is most complicated. It is no more real, but there are some symmetries for these two on-site terms, and you see you need two Q vectors to have the complete symmetry. So you need to compute two Q vectors, or you need to change all the structure of your code, retrieving the value for one Q from one Q to minus Q. But if I want to do that, I have to change all the PAW routines. And at that time, it was only spin polarized. I was able to manage that, finding some symmetries in the imaginary part of these terms. And I was able to handle that, only adding a complex part to these quantities. OK, but what happened now when I mixed non-collinear magnetism and DFPT? So I have to mix the two symmetries. The first one, the complex, these are complex numbers due to spin orbit coupling. And in the second case, these are complex numbers due to the phase of the Q. And these are not the same symmetries. And the symmetries are written there. These are not complicated formula, but as you can see, I need these two Q, I need this symmetry with respect to spinors. And at that time, I was not able to manage that with the existing structures in Abinet. It was not possible, or I had to rewrite everything. So I decided to change the way we store that, and then decided to separate the imaginary part from the phase and the imaginary part from the spin orbit coupling. And it was not complicated to imagine, but I simply separate the phase into reals. And then doing that, my rho ij, my first order rho ij in non-collinear magnetism was represented by four scalars. And these four scalars have exactly the same symmetry as the initial implementation, the one I did 12 years ago. AIJR is AJIR. So doing this, I am able to reuse all my initial coding, but I have to call the routine twice or four times for each scalar. And the most complicated part was the symmetry of the row IJ, and I was able to handle that because the symmetry of these terms is the same as the initial coding. So I have decided to store with this representation, including a phase, including the spin orbit complexity. My point was that LiPo is now used by several codes, and I didn't want to change the API. So that's the reason why I didn't add an extra dimension to the array, but I multiplied by two to have the complex. Okay, I've written several generic routines that can handle every case. First order, zero order, non-collinear, and so on. And it was implemented, and all the tests passed. and it is in the trunk. Okay, I finished because I will not talk about GGA, but because I need time to explain the expansion in spherical harmonics. But I have to mix that now with GGA. Okay, it's not complicated, but the number of terms to handle is large. You see, in LDA you have only two terms, and in GGA this is a work. This is not related to PAW. This is already existing in a norm-conserving pseudo potential. Okay, I go in directly. I wanted to show you some physical results. It's a computation done in GGA plus DFPT. Not yet including spin orbit coupling, but it is. I wanted to illustrate and to show you that it works. So it's a computation that did Grégory with the. And it's a collaboration with some experimentalists in our group. So, Gregory, correct me if I say something wrong, but it's dense nitrogen. They have synthesized dense nitrogen and performed Raman spectroscopy on the samples, and you have computed the corresponding graphs, and these are two stable phis you find, and the experimental one. One, this one has been found by the experimentalists, and you see the two phases are at least in GGA dynamically stable because there are no negative modes. Okay, this is a recent paper. So my conclusion, current status. So you can read so that DFPT and GGA is okay. Spinors, it's my private version. You know, we do not open versions for two reasons. First reasons, it's not ready because the checks have not been completely realized. And the second reason, you want to publish with this implementation. So If I know that a lot of people ask me, when is the GGA plus DFPT ready? So it is ready, but we need some time to use it for our own use. Okay, but it will merge soon after more checking. It's available for all perturbation except strain, but it is not connected to that. And there is an additional term for strain. I need time in Don's implementation in norm-conserving pseudo-potential. The non-linear core correction term has been implemented in real space, and we have implemented it in reciprocal space in PAW, and I need just to change, to adapt this to non-collinear magnetism. Okay, that's it.